Our world is for the forceful and not for sentimental folk, but brilliant and resourceful and paranoid gentlefolk.
Not soft and sentimental folk.
So I've got the fun job, which is I get to sit and listen and ask a couple questions. But I want to introduce you to wonderful people up here. On piano is Randy Redd, who in our production also plays Dr. Bigby Denby. Is that correct? Yes. And then Claybourne Elder, who is Joe Jr. in our show. Then Jane Pfitsch, who is playing Emily in Allegro, and George Abood, who plays Charlie in Allegro. And then next to me is Ted Chapin, who is the president and executive director of Rodgers and Hammerstein. So responsible for the Cinderella that's with us now and the King and I that's coming up and hundreds of other shows in between and before.
Say
and
yes.
Yes. But also the author of the best behind-the-scenes making of a musical book ever written, Everything Was Possible, The Making of Follies. It's, you have to run out. If you haven't read this book, you have to go get this. It's an incredible story of that period of time.
I should have set up a stand.
And then John Doyle, the extraordinary director who... And it makes me so happy to say these next couple words, that he is the associate director at Classic Stage Company. I can't tell you how, I can say that over and over again. He's the associate director at Classic Stage Company. We're so happy to have him as part of CSC. John did the Passion, Stephen Sondheim's Passion, and James Lapine's Passion for us. You know his work from the Sweeney Todd that he did on Broadway, and the Company, just recently The Visit, which I'm hoping you'll see here. So we're in good company, and so I have some questions, and you'll have some questions, and we'll hear some songs. We thought, because you know, it would be good, we'd start with a song, yes? You know, just to warm things up. So this, we're gonna begin with a song that comes almost at the end of the show, called, appropriately, Allegro.
Our world is for the forceful and not for sentimental folk, but brilliant and resourceful and paranoid gentlefolk.
Not soft and sentimental folk.
Allegro, a musician, would so describe the speed of it, the clash and competition of counterpoint.
The need of it.
We cannot prove the need of it. We know no other way of living out a day. Our music must be galloping and gay.
We muffle all the undertones, the minor blood and thunder tones. The overtones are all we care to play.
Hysterically frantic, we are stubbornly romantic and doggedly determined to be gay.
Allegro. Same tempo, morning and night, Allegro. Don't stop whatever you do. Do something dizzy and new. Keep up the hullabaloo, Allegro.
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 We spin and we spin and we spin and we spin, playing a game no one can win. The men who corner wheat, the men who corner gin, the men who rule the airwaves, the denizens of din.
They spin and they spin, they spin and they spin. The girls who dig for gold and won't give in for tin. The lilies of the field, so femininely thin. They toil not, but oh, how they spin. Oh, how they spin. Oh, how they spin.
Amazing love with cake. May's husband, he's in love with Sue. Sue's in love with May's husband, what are they to do? Tom's in love with Tim's wife, she's in love with Sam. Sam's in love with Tom's wife, so they're in a jam.
They are smart little sheep who have lost their way. Blah, blah, blah.
Musical theater novice. So I always thought that Rodgers and Hammerstein were the traditionalists. They were, and really in learning about this show and spending more time with the canon of work, it's fair to say they were really the experimentalists, isn't that? I mean, could we talk just a little bit about what music theater was before Rodgers and Hammerstein's Oklahoma and,
sure.
and then what they did that changed the rules?
Sure. I mean, I think the remarkable thing about Richard Rodgers and Oscar Hammerstein coming together to write the musical based on Green Grow the Lilacs, they were both of them part of teams that were still functional. Oscar Hammerstein with Jerome Kern and Richard Rodgers with Lorenz Hart. And neither Lorenz Hart nor Jerome Kern was remotely interested in Green Grow the Lilacs. So and the Theater Guild wanted to do it as a musical, and actually at one point it was announced in the Times that it was gonna be lyrics by Hart, libretto by Hammerstein, music by Rodgers. But basically it was a one-off. That, you know, their partner said, okay, we'll let you do this. I mean, why not? You guys wanna do this show, it's a terrible idea, but we'll see what happens. And it ended up being Oklahoma. And I think the thing about Oklahoma that I always sort of have come to feel is, it's not that it by itself was the revolutionary musical that that came out of nowhere, because it was the musical that took all the experimental things that other musicals and other people had been attempting to do, including Rodgers and separately Hammerstein, but you know, Lady in the Dark and On Your Toes and all kinds of different things. But it's the one that sort of put all of those things together and actually made the musical sort of an artistic whole. You know, and there was a great quote from Richard Rodgers. He said, you know, the music, the orchestrations sound the way the costumes look. Because prior to it, it would, you know, Ethel Merman would stomp down stage front and sing a great big Cole Porter song and then go back into some frivolous plot. And I mean, that's an oversimplification, but that's kind of where the musical theater was. So the fact that when they wrote Oklahoma, their rule was it's got to be the drama. It's got to be the story. You know, and if it's not going to start with a chorus, but in fact, you know, Aunt Ella churning butter and from offstage a cappella we hear, you know, Oh, What a Beautiful Morning, it's like, that's the way we think it should start. And that's kind of, you know, how they became their own revolutionaries, but the voice, their own voice was like they just did what they felt was right. And because they brought these years of accumulated experience together, it just hit.
And so this is, so then, and then you have these extraordinary things like in Carousel, that sort of that last song, that which is really like a soliloquy.
Yeah, I mean, clearly, the other thing that's important to note about Oklahoma, of course, is that audiences embraced it. You know, it's one thing to be innovative and artistically superior, but when audiences love it and keep coming for 3,000 performances, that tells you something, especially in the musical theater. And clearly, one wonders what actually happened with the collaborations. I mean, they actually, interesting, Rodgers and Hammerstein after Oklahoma, Rodgers went back and did a revival of Connecticut Yankee with Lorenz Hart, and Hammerstein brought Kern to do a revival of Showboat. And it is sort of ironic that both Lorenz Hart and Jerome Kern died 2 years later. So it's like, in the big picture, it's like, I guess these are over, this is the new thing. But they just kept writing. They wrote a new musical for Broadway every other year, from Oklahoma until The Sound of Music, and then Hammerstein died. That's the only thing that stopped it from continuing.
That's unbelievable. And so Allegro sits, it's this sort of extraordinary caesura, right between, you've got Oklahoma, then Carousel, then Allegro, then South Pacific, and King and I.
Right, right.
And is it fair to say Allegro is sort of the lost child in a little bit?
I mean, it was the innovator's innovation, because they didn't want to repeat themselves. And, you know, and actually Steve Sondheim, who was a gopher on the original production of Oklahoma, of Allegro, said that that Oscar said, they just want us to do the same show we've done before, and we don't want to do that. You know, so this was one of the two originals that they came. This was Hammerstein's idea, and the other one was Rodgers' idea. Neither one of them worked. Interesting, whatever. You know, and they felt this one, and it's interesting because both men had seen failure in their lives, and while Allegro was arguably not a success, it did run for a year and a half. I mean, it wasn't a closeout failure, and some critics just thought it was an unbelievably glorious work of art, while others thought it was sort of pretentious and wasn't interested. But the lack of success of Allegro hurt, and both men kept thinking about it. And actually, when Hammerstein died, he was writing a television adaptation of Allegro. So just interesting that even though it wasn't a show on the equal to the shows around it, the creators, who clearly hadn't lost their touch, but something about what they wanted to do didn't work the way they wanted it to work. And that gnawed at him, which I think is fascinating.
And there's that great quote of Richard Rodgers that he said, of all the shows that didn't quite succeed, the one that I'd like to see have a second chance is Allegro. And why do you think that is? What was so...
Because I think it has enormous ambitions. I mean, originally the idea was an everyman story from birth to death. And then it got readjusted for whatever reason to birth, sort of midlife crisis and rejuvenation. And then it was on instinct. I mean, they just created these characters. They chose to write the story about a doctor because they figured that was, you know, a profession that you could talk about, you know, how you learn and then sometimes can be seduced into doing things that are socially proper but perhaps professionally wrong. But also, one of the most interesting things that is said about Hammerstein's idea of Allegro was that he had gotten to a point in his life, he had worked for years, I mean, his first show was in the 20s, and, you know, Oklahoma was 1943, Carousel was 1945, and suddenly he became an icon, and he was asked to go on every committee, and, you know, because people loved him, and he was on the Authors League, he was the president of the Authors League and the New World Federalists, and the point that he wanted to make was, when you get to a point in your career when you're very, very good at it, and you're then noted and part of a larger society, and everybody wants a piece of you. They want you on the board. They want you to help, you know, raise money for this. And it's kind of, as he said in this wonderful introduction to the published script of Allegro, it's a conspiracy against letting you do what it is that got you there in the first place. And as Sondheim said, a rather esoteric point of view, perhaps. And he said that the audience didn't get it. They thought it was an anti-city, pro-country story, which, you know, in the way the story is told, you can see where that could come, but that's not what they wanted. So they didn't succeed in telling the story that they wanted to tell.
And so when we say experimental, we could say, or work playing more with the form, we could say that this has a chorus that functions like a Greek chorus, as opposed to a chorus that just comes out and repeats a couple of lines that the main singer sings.
Yeah, there were three choruses, the dancing chorus, the singing chorus, and the speaking chorus. I assume you have that in this production.
Right all here.
No, but the idea of having a Greek chorus that would both speak what is going on in the character's mind or comment on what's happening, you know, or just say things that get us to the next place, and singing chorus would do like, and then the dancing chorus. Because Agnes DeMille, it was the first time that there was a director choreographer for a musical, and since it was Agnes DeMille, it was the first time there was a woman director choreographer. And it's funny, this afternoon in preparation for this, I took a look at Agnes DeMille's book, and she has a chapter in her second book, I think, called R&H, and fascinating. Not a mention of Allegro, which was the end of their collaboration, except in the movie of Oklahoma.
In getting a chance to watch the company and John work, one of the things that I found fascinating is my notion of the American musical is you got a bunch of people on stage, And one person steps out of that bunch of people and goes, I'm the one you should look at. And I'm going to sing an I Want song. You know, they sang a song that set up the world. But I'm going to sing what I want. And you're going to follow my want. I'm going to get it. And it's about individuating from the chorus and getting your thing. And either you survive, and usually, thankfully, in American musicals, the character survives and gets what he wants. And if they die, it's an opera, you know. But what's fascinating to me about Allegro is a person emerges from the chorus and goes, you know, I'm not so sure I like it out here in the spotlight. I think I'm going to go back and be in the chorus. And I find that to be a genuinely moving, profound notion when you do go home, when Claybourne goes home. I find it immensely moving because it just goes against the whole way American musicals were conceived, that whole frontier, I'm going to step out and forge a new territory called downstage. It's going to be mine, which I find just fascinating. Not a question, I'm sorry, but I just...
I'm trying to figure out how to get him into this.
Yes, no.
We got to hear from
him. We had to do this. I had to make an outline for this, and my outline said, we have to talk to Ted first, and then we sing another song, and then we talk to John. So I think we're at that place now where we can sing another song because it's time, right? You need another song.
Yeah.
And this is a song that actually has had a life outside of the show, and the song is from Allegro, and it crops up in performers' acts, and you may have heard it in the past. It's going to be Jane is going to sing it, and it's called "A Gentleman Is a Dope."
Yeah.
Okay.
The boss gets on my nerves. I've got a good mind to quit. I've taken all I can. It's time to get up and get and move to another job or maybe another town. The gentleman burns me up. The gentleman gets me down. The gentleman is a dope, a man of many faults, a clumsy Joe who wouldn't know a rumba from a waltz. The gentleman is a dope and not my cup of tea. Why do I get in a dither? He doesn't belong to me. The gentleman isn't bright. He doesn't know the score. A cake will come, he'll take a crumb and never ask for more. The gentleman's eyes are blue, but little do they see. Why am I beating my brains out? He doesn't belong to me. He's somebody else's problem. She's welcome to the guy. She'll never understand him half as well as I. The gentleman is a dope. He isn't very smart. He's just a lug you'd like to hug and hold against your heart. The gentleman doesn't know how happy he could be. Look at me crying my eyes out as if he belonged to me.
So John, so we sort of said, you know, whatever you want to do next, you can do, and you chose Allegro. So talk about that. What's going on there?
Yeah, I mean there are many many reasons. Yes, you did say anything you can do, you can do. But you know, the stage is only like 16 feet by 14 feet, so you can't really do quite anything
right,
you want to do.
True.
You know, if I give you all the different strands of why. When you and I first met and we talked about doing a piece of work at CSC, and I said, please can I do a play because I can read words and I never get to do plays, and Brian said, well, couldn't you do a musical because we really like to have a musical? And because of my relationship with Steve Sondheim, I thought, okay, what can I do that would be a balance between a musical and a play? And to me, passion fulfilled that, and the nature of the story of passion also fulfill the title of your theater, which is a classic stage company. It's a classic story. It's a big, epic story, even though it's only told by a small number of people. Then when it came, and then fortunately, that was quite successful, so you said to me, would you like to do another musical? And I was happy, of course, to do that because I like working at classic stage. And I thought, well, I don't want to do another Sondheim. I mean, I would do any Sondheim all the time, to be frank with you, but I didn't want it to become the Sondheim series done by me. What could I think of that had some link to Steve? And that got me thinking about Hammerstein, and then I thought, well, which Rodgers and Hammerstein could one possibly do in a small space? He'd given me, two or three years back, the very good box CD of Allegro, and I'd listened to that, and I'd enjoyed it. And I mean, he'd done no more than give me this gift. It was not, as far as I knew, he wasn't fishing for anything.
Oh, you never.
And as I listened to that, and I thought, well, you know, there is an everyman story in here. There is a classic story. There is some. This piece does follow somebody's life. It has a Greek chorus, so there's something. I mean, I now call it the American chorus, yes. But there is something classic about that. There is something in the structure of a group of people telling an audience a story to which that group of people already knows the answer. Mm-hmm. They know the ending, just like the classic Greek chorus did, and that you're following the catharsis of really one person through that journey. I thought, okay, this has got some classic structure that's interesting. I was then very interested in the fact that it's never really worked, because I really love trying to do things that have never really worked, because you've sort of got nothing to lose, because you can get to the end and it's a disaster, and you say, well, it never really worked anyway, so it's not my fault. So there's something kind of glorious about that, but there is also something glorious about trying to make something work. And fortunately, because of our friendship, having some support in the possibility of a little change here and there to help to find a way of doing it, right?
I have to, if you don't mind,
No, stop.
I have to say that it's so unique to have an estate, so to speak, that is so open to
totally
changes
unique.
Because that's not the way most...
It's just much more fun that way.
Much more fun.
No, but also I'm a hired hand. I mean, a lot of estate people have emotional baggage. And luckily, well, Mary Rodgers had emotional baggage, which she could have cared less about. And, you know, she was just caution to the wind. She would have loved this. But
And then I suppose the final bit of that puzzle was, people, I do this thing that people call my signature style, where people play the score as well as everything else. I mean, you know, I've done over 300 shows in my life, and only 20 of them have been with acting musicians, so I don't really call it my signature style. But, you know, I'd better to be known for something than nothing at all, I suppose.
And that Tony Award on the show.
Well, yes, I know. That. It's not on the shelf, it's in the shoe cupboard, actually. I was looking for something that I could approach with using acting musicianship again. I'm very particular about when I use that form, that technique, because I've gone beyond the days of why I created the idea, right? But I thought, this could maybe, I don't know, help is too arrogant a word, but it could be a means to an end with Allegro, in terms of if it's a Greek chorus who are telling the story, why can't they play the story as well? Why can't they do absolutely everything? And the thing that I'm more interested in being known for is being minimalist about what I do. You know, we do it with two benches and a chair and a piano and the instruments and the actors, and that's it, you know, as you know, you've seen. So I think there's a simplicity in the storytelling form that the actor musicianship suits, and I think gives the piece even more heart than it already had in a strange way.
I love with actor musicians, and I'd be curious how you guys feel, but watching you guys, it's so wonderful to watch artists support each other on stage, because you're creating the subtext for your fellow actor.
It's
a huge responsibility.
Yeah, it's the ultimate ensemble. It truly is. I mean, you know, we couldn't do the Agnes B. DeMille version in your space. No. It would be...
You'd have to use the lobby and go out into the
streets. It would just be bizarre. Yeah. So I thought, okay, I have to come up with something that not makes up for that, but represents that in a different way. And I think what the acting musicianship does is it gives it tremendous movement to the piece itself. And of course, because we are doing it with 12 people who also play the whole score, the characters in Joe's life are the chorus. So they're not, the chorus is not a group of anonymous right. people. In this particular production, they are the people of his life who are telling his story for him.
And does it, is it, I mean, I thought it was so funny because when we had to do a rehearsal beforehand, and you all play instruments during your song, so it was, it must be a strange, right, to suddenly be naked without your instrument while you're singing.
During our sound check, I think all of us were sitting here thinking, dun, 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 dun,
dun, saw a lot of fingering dun, happening while they were singing. And is it terrifying to like suddenly be acting with your instrument while you're acting and singing, and then John has you like walking around and like moving and like cellos. You're walking. You're lying on the ground with a cello, yeah. plucking pizzicato.
I think an instrument is so much a part of ourselves, especially musicians or actors who have played instruments. I think most of us have played our whole lives or a great part of our lives. So it's just another, it's an extension of the body rather than like a cost, rather than
right.
something you put on,
right.
you know? So it feels quite natural to do that and to move around or walk around or do that in any capacity. The difficulty is the technique is trying to, of the counterpoint between playing and singing sometimes, which is tricky, but it really grounds you. It takes you out of this this silly-nilly place.
I think there are two things about that, too. First of all, the show is called Allegro.
Yes.
So it's a musical, it's dealing with a musical form and a musical tempo in relation to what we say about our lives. So that's really interesting. And then I think the other thing which Elizabeth brought out, Elizabeth Davis, who's in our cast, who was in Once as well, and what she talked about was that she'd realized that the way we were making the show, that the instrumentation and the way you move with your instrument, even if you're not singing, can demonstrate your subtext in a way that could never otherwise be done, because normally you'd be sitting there, or in the case of her character, you might be in the dressing room for most of the night. You know, I mean, like there's two people die in the course of the show, the grandmother and the mother, who are fundamental to the story, but they wouldn't even be on stage if they weren't doing all the tasks that they're asked to do in this particular way of doing it.
In watching, I thought, you know, although this originated in England, I thought this is very American because it's like, and I also thought, thank God for marching bands, you know, because did you guys do, you know, I was just thinking, you know, there's something very, because it's so mobile, it's so up, in the space moving.
Sure. Look, I mean, you know, I have a few things to respond to about that, which is one, we wouldn't be sitting here talking about it. I would be retired by now if it hadn't been for Steve Sondheim, right? Who saw Sweeney Todd in London in a small theater and said to me that night afterwards, I'd really like this to come to Broadway. I nearly passed out. I'd never met Stephen Sondheim, let alone such a thing. But he could see that this was another way of telling stories, right? It was very interesting for me during the preview period of Sweeney Todd when I would stand outside the canopy. It was in the fall and it was nice weather. And all these people were saying, who does this director think he is? How dare he do this? What would Stephen Sondheim think? And you think, do you really think we'd be on 49th Street doing this if he didn't give his approval? But because of that, we came to audition for Sweeney, and I'd said to the producers, don't advertise the show until you know that you can cast it. Because I don't know, you know, I'd been working with people. There's a four-year training program in Britain where I'm a fellow of the school, that teaches it as a form. I don't know. And then I started auditioning people. Mark Jacoby came in and played his trumpet, and he hadn't played his trumpet since high school band, and then played the judge on Broadway. And I thought, oh, of course, John, there's a whole tradition that you've just mentioned that I had become, that I wasn't really aware of. We don't have marching band. So you're right. It's natural. And what's very interesting about this, I think you'd all agree, is that Mary Mitchell Campbell, who's the other half of me, to be honest, I mean, it's all very well what I do, but I couldn't do what she does, which is orchestrate this work. It's an enormous task. Much of what my brief to her was, do everything that is good about Richard Rodgers, but give it a quality of Copland at the same time. Give it a total sense of Americanness at the same time, not American musical theater, but something beyond that. And I think within the limited resources, she's absolutely achieved that quality. So you hear things on instruments you wouldn't otherwise hear.
Do we get a tuba this time?
No tuba.
Hattie LaPointe playing the tuba in Sweeney Todd was it?
It had to be seen to be believed. Right. She actually could, you know, I don't know if you've ever seen pictures of it, but she actually played the euphonium in her high school band. And I was not prepared to let that short lady wear a euphonium around her body.
Can I ask which instruments these guys play in the show, since I don't know?
I play the violin and the banjo and the ukulele right now, today.
This week.
Mm-hmm. I play the violin and the guitar and the trumpet.
And everything else. I play the violin and the cello and the guitar. I think we're all violinists first off,
yes.
Aren't we?
Yeah.
Us three, at least. A lot of the cast are.
There's a lot of violins in this show.
Yeah.
Makes me want to see it.
And is it piano? And
piano, clarinet,
oh,
and mandolin.
Wow, oh my goodness. And like, I heard that, Claybourne, you were sending tapes, like, I can do this on a washboard. Is
well,
that,
you know, how this process starts, I guess, normally, is Mary Mitchell emails us all and asks us what instruments we play, and she told, you know, we email her and rate ourselves from 1 to 10. And she reminds us that we've already got the job and we don't have to lie. And then we give her... We give her, and she came back to me and said, well, do you think you could learn how to play the banjo? And I was like, I bet I could learn how to, I have one, I could learn how to play the banjo. And then she asked me to learn how to play the saxophone, which I also learned how to play and am not playing. but I think that, I mean, you play 1,000 instruments. And there are several other people in the show that truly play 5 or 6 instruments really quite well.
And she's done things with the orchestration where the story happens in two worlds, a sort of Midwest, small town environment, and then Chicago. And so she's orchestrated in such a way that in the small town world, it is all violins, clarinet, cellos, and guitars. But then when you go to Chicago, you start hearing the saxophone and the trumpets. And so more of a city sound comes into the soundscape that the actors use.
So I'm curious. And so you've compressed the show.
I have. I'm doing it without an intermission because I wanted to follow the Greek drama idea of not having an intermission. And because we can't do the big dance numbers, actually, when you really read the text, I've not actually cut very much. In fact, I've cut less out of this than, God help us, than most things I've done in my life. The text is very, Steve expressed it very beautifully, I think, when he said it's very simple. Mm-hmm. And often simple is a dirty word nowadays in the theater. But this, or a negative word, but there's something very pure. I was saying to Ted today, you know, it really struck me about how we forget that not only did Hammerstein write the lyrics, but he wrote the book as well. Not many people do that or even could do that. And so there is a purity in the book. So I haven't actually cut the text very much at all. But because of not being able to do the big Agnes B. DeMille world, the storytelling is therefore compressed. Mm-hmm. I think it's going to work nicely without an intermission. And I think, who knows, it would be an arrogance to say what helps anything. As I said, I don't know, we're still rehearsing it. I don't know if it'll work or not. I hope it does, for everybody's sake, but I don't. If I knew, I wouldn't do it. Yeah? I sense that the arc of the storytelling may benefit from not having a break, because it's not your typical well-made show, whatever that means, you know? It doesn't reach its act one terrible dramatic climax and then all resolve in the second half. It's slightly different to that. And I've also taken a slight twist on it in terms of there is a breakdown that his character has quite near the end, which I find really interesting. It's very well written in the text. It's really interesting. And I've taken two lines from that and started the show with them. So you get a sense that the show is something that's come out of something terrible happening in his life, and that he's revisiting his life at different points of his life out of that moment of crisis. And then the crisis gets resolved by the most beautiful song, which you're not going to hear.
called, you have to come and see it. Yeah,
a song called Come Home, which, to be frank, if I really had to say to you why I wanted to do Allegro, it was for that song. Yeah. Because I think, not for any sentimental reason, you know, my home is, as you can tell by my voice, is a long way away, and it's in the mountains of Scotland. But I don't think, for me, the home that is being talked about is not a place. It's a piece. Mm-hmm. It's about peace, and it's about how you find peace in this crazy Allegro world that we live in, which, as God knows, crazier now than it probably was then, you know? So that's fascinating, I think.
In watching it, I thought, you know, that this piece, sometimes when people talk about it, they sort of say, well, it's the American musical's attempt to be like Our Town, you know, to try to tell a story in non-traditional terms. In non-traditional meaning, it just isn't necessarily American naturalism. People break the fourth wall and speak to the audience, those sorts of things. But I found it fascinating that it contains the two Americas that I think have been with us since the inception of this country. There's the America of family and the love that happens in a home, and how that radiates from home to home and sort of makes a community. And that's one part of the American dream. And the other part is the idea of you have to leave that. You leave that, and you go out in the world, you go to the frontier, and you found a new Eden. You go to Chicago in this case, or you go here. And that really, the piece really speaks about these two dialectically opposed Americas, because we all want the home, and we also want the individual to go out west and make something of ourselves and become that success story, that Horatio Alger. And it seems like the piece really captures that.
Oh, yeah.
That struggle between two worlds.
Oh, truly does. And also, I think what is delicate and absolutely delicious is that the whole change in this man's life happens because of one word, the word ornament. He realizes that he's an ornament, like, you know, and that he's making a speech, and he catches himself say this one word, and it changes direction for him. It's like Peer Gynt in that sense. Yes. It changes his way forward. And his way forward, which none of us always like, is to go back. Yeah. Which in some senses goes against the American dream, if you want to put it that way.
Right, and I think in my pet theory, and it's only, you know, it really is a theory, because I was in the room and watching the work that all of you guys were doing, and I'm biased, but I think it's really kind of amazing what's happening in this little rehearsal room, and I hope that when it transfers to CSC, sometimes when you transfer something, the beauty of a room doesn't always, but I have faith. But the thing that I had this theory, which is that I wonder if an audience of 1947-ish didn't want to hear this about go home, go back. In a way, it's like, hey, we just got through the Depression.
Well, and a
we
war.
We just got through a war.
Of course.
And we've worked really hard and struggled to obtain this thing called success, to become the American century, and we need to just move forward. What are you telling us? Go back. What is that? What's ridiculous? Are you ashamed of success? Are you ashamed of this sort of thing?
Sure.
But hearing this piece now, we really are the children of those choices, and the idea that Hammerstein is talking about an internal home, I think that's what you say is absolutely true.
Correct.
It's not that you literally have to go home, because, you know, Dorothy gets to go home, and I guess Thomas Wolfe says you can't go home. But Hammerstein says you can go home internally, and that's your compass, and that's your
best.
That's
right.
And I think that's what's really kind of extraordinary about this piece, hearing it in this Allegro world.
And as a non-American, it's universal. I mean, that's not just
an American
idea.
Story.
No.
At the end of the day, it's everybody's
story. Absolutely.
Can I say something about Agnes DeMille? Because a couple of times John has said that you're not going to see the Agnes DeMille ballets or dances in this. I think it's kind of fascinating that for all the innovations that Rodgers and Hammerstein put into Allegro, including having Agnes DeMille, who had done extraordinary work in both Oklahoma and Carousel, using dance as part of storytelling, what's interesting is the dance in Allegro really doesn't do that. And they're really kind of, you know, musical comedy, more musical comedy mentality. Now we have a dance where the children will show you that they're children. Now he goes to college, and now we'll show you what people in college. And there's this thing in the college dance about this is what we think we're like, this is what we really like. An interesting idea. And then the big, you know, Allegro ballet at the end, you know, of the how terrible the city is. And it's interesting that. I say that because I don't think you're going to miss it if you see the show, but it's also interesting that those dances are forgotten, they're lost, because once this show finished its New York run and its tour, you know, it sort of went away, and a few years ago there was an attempt to try to recreate them just for historical standpoint, and there was nobody around who remembered it enough, so just interesting you really can't do Carousel in Oklahoma without doing the dances in some form. You can do Allegro without the dances.
Yes, definitely, definitely. Do we have, so I heard this thing, cards, you've got cards, and I'm supposed to get the cards, and I read the cards, and they answer? This is great. And how am I doing time-wise? I'm doing just fine. I can't believe it, that's so rare. I've got to tell my wife I'm on time. was Allegro based on any source material?
No. No, not at all. It's a complete original.
So this is, and in the Rodgers and Hammerstein, there's two other examples?
There's one other example, Me and Juliet, which after this one, which was Hammerstein's idea, then they sort of loaded the deck by taking, in South Pacific, bringing on Josh Logan, a bona fide, you know, force of nature, then The King and I, and Rodgers said, let's do a musical comedy, let's throw back to the old days and do what stopped when we started writing together. And so Me and Juliet is not terribly good.
Oh, no. But it's like a backstage love story, right? An actress falls in love with an electrician?
Right. It's on stage, off stage, kind of stuff.
I love that, electrician and actress.
Someday you'll see it in Encores, maybe. John?
Since Rodgers and Hammerstein were producers, what was the life of Allegro during their lifetime?
They didn't actually produce. They didn't produce Allegro. It was the last one that the Theater Guild produced. I have a feeling the Theater Guild was fine with that.
Because they survived, right?
They survived. They survived, and because it's never happy when a show doesn't really work. And there was an accusation that the Theater Guild had booked the theater, so they had to do it, and Hammerstein wasn't finished with the second act, so it forced him to finish this. I don't know what the actual fact is in all of that, but I think by the end of it, the Theater Guild went its way, and Rodgers and Hammerstein went their way. And they co-produced South Pacific and then produced pretty much the ones until The Sound of Music, where they were the last people in, and they were co-producers of Sound of Music.
Wow. And, okay, now, how was Rodgers and Hammerstein planning to change Allegro for the TV ad?
Well, the funny thing about the outline that Hammerstein, that exists, I think I sent it to John, just because I'm the kind of person, if someone like John's going to do this, I want to give him every piece of information that I have at the office. Some directors, I don't do that, because they'll fall in love with something that was cut for a reason, and it's like a bad idea. But the first thing that Hammerstein did, which I find so ironic, is the bad girl, the Jenny, the girl that he marries and then ends up having an affair and leaves for the secretary, he makes her a nice person. And I thought, therefore, and there goes the only really dramatically interesting in this whole show. So it's like, but what he was really fascinated by is that the camera was going to be Joe Jr. as a kid. So there's a song, One Foot, Other Foot, about the child being born and learning to walk. And so he was he thought was a very cool idea. The camera would be really down low like a baby and would look up at all the grown-ups.
And Cinderella was originally television.
Yeah, that was.
Was that their first foray?
Yeah, absolutely. That was an original, you know, commission from CBS to do a 90-minute television special live.
Wow, that's amazing.
Yeah. And they wrote, just one thing I love about that is that it was announced in September of 1956. And it aired 7 months later. Oh. So the whole thing was written, created, cast, staged, everything in 7 months.
Unbelievable.
They knew what they were doing, those boys.
Okay, now this is an excellent question. Ted, is there a CD of the show?
Oh, please. Plant that. I don't know what to do. Yes, the CD that John refers to. One of the pleasures of the job I've had for many years at the Rodgers and Hammerstein organization. I keep telling people I didn't have gray hair when I started, but I come by it honestly. Because Allegro had been talked about and nobody knew it. The original cast album is 32 minutes long. Because that's all that RCA Victor could figure out they could pull from the show that sounded like songs. And I kept thinking, this is a very, very interesting show. So through a circuitous reason, we ended up making a cast, a studio recording of Allegro that is complete. And we did it in exactly the way you should never make a recording. We did the orchestra first. We recorded it in Bratislava. Because it was really inexpensive, and I thought if this is a huge failure, I can hide it sort of with the, and it worked well. And then we cast it. We didn't no idea who was going to be in it when we did the recording. But it was so funny over there saying, why don't you do a little rubato here? Why don't you make it sound? And then when we cast it and brought the singers in and said, guys, hate to tell you, but you're taking a rubato right there because that's where the orchestra does. I have to say they were all great. So the challenge was to make a recording that sounded like a cast album of a production, and I think it does. The production never existed. But it's two CDs, and it's everything. It has all the dance music, so you can listen to it and figure out what the hell they were all about.
It's also interesting in that if you listen to and those and the orchestrations are based on the
they are the original, the absolutely original, the yes. Robert Russell Bennett originals.
So that if you listen then to what John and Mary have done, it's really fascinating to see how they've rethought this in terms of the sound and the instrumentation of the.
And we've actually given them. The full scores, copies of the full scores of what the original show was, because I think it was smarter for us, rather than have Mary Mitchell make it up out of thin air, it's like, if you want to know what Robert Russell Bennett did, here's what he did. And musician to musician, if you have violins and stuff like that, here's the way they did it. And it's a better thing for a musician to look, so that ornamentation was in the flute. That kind of stuff.
Why Allegro now?
Why Allegro now? I think the whole idea of a person, forget the actual, the fact that in this case his wife encourages him to go to Chicago to become a rich doctor. Exactly. Take the wife element out of that, and just his journey to go to be led away from that which is natural to that which is lucrative, and the implications of that. I come from a country of socialized medicine, as you call it, but so I have a different view of what that is anyway. But it's not about a doctor, right? I mean, the plot happens to lie in a doctor, but the thrust of the story is not about that. It is about, as Hammerstein said, how any individual can become submerged and lose their soul, potentially, by the pressure to either do well or be good, or make a lot of money, be successful, however you might quantify that. I think those pressures all still exist, and it's as relevant as ever. And I teach at Princeton, and all of my Princeton students have come to watch us work in the rehearsal room, which has been really great, isn't it, to hear them talk about the piece. And there was one young man that I was talking about today who he was getting very upset in a way by the fact that the family were putting the man of the story under such pressure from birth. You know, his grandmother says, be a good boy, don't cry, all those things that were told. And I could see he was becoming very impassioned about this. I said, this isn't about the story, this is about you, isn't it? He said, yes, this is about me. And I thought, yeah, those pressures all still exist and we can all still lose our souls. For me personally, he referred to my Tony Award that's in the shoe closet. But that those events in your life, if you're not very careful, can change you in a not very good way. Which is why I don't ever look at it. I will when I start working, but I'm not going to until then, right? Stritch said to me, I got a message on the phone the day after I won it. John, I'm really pleased for you. Now put it on the mantle and forget all about it. And it's absolutely true. And with it, because you could stop yourself from being an artist by sitting on boards and being celebrated, and it's not a good thing. And that must apply to many people sitting in this room tonight, I would say.
Yeah. No, it's. I was surprised at how much it made me think about getting a chance to see the work. You know, just where the country is now, and the choices that we've made over the past 60 years since this piece was made. And the piece sort of says, that was one road, but there's this other road that the country could have taken. And it's just interesting to contemplate that other road, which is home, family, community, over materialism and success.
We still can do that. We don't have to not.
Although, you know, you think, you know, you can't, you know, we've got to support the economy and this sort of thing.
Can I ask one question?
Please.
Are you finding the song so far difficult to fit into your show?
Absolutely not at all.
I say it because it's the one song that was not actually written for Allegro.
I know. You know, there's something so beautiful about the lyric and so wonderful about the notion that we have nothing to remember so far, that you're so young that you have nothing yet to remember. It's a wonderful, wonderful idea. And to me, that song, and you'll notice that there are two men and a woman here, right? Well, I don't know how many of you know Merrily We Roll Along, but there is a connection very strongly for me in Merrily and this. His character's even called Charlie, if you know Merrily We Roll Along, right? And she's the girl that doesn't really get the guy. That's all familiar stuff and all about looking at our lives at different times. So I don't have any trouble with it. I don't think we've not taken a song out, have we? All the songs are there and nothing's come out. I've tinkered around with the very end.
Don't tell me.
I think you'll like how it finishes up.
When Encores did Allegro, which was the second show that Encores did, and Steve Sondheim came and gave a wonderful talk, and then I was sitting next to him, and when it came to the end where the three are going back home, he turned and he said, "That's where we got it." He had forgotten that.
Yeah.
So this is the last question, appropriately. What is next for CSC's Musical Theater Initiative? John, what is next for CSC's Musical Theater Initiative?
I don't know really.
A Rodgers and Hart, can I put a chit in?
I don't know. The musicals that we do together, I think, have all got to somehow reflect the name of your theater. I really do think that's important, that they have got to be kind of epic stories told in an intimate way. And ideally pieces that have a direct relationship with the audience. So I don't know. I mean, people often say to me, what would you like to do next? In all sorts of ways. And to be honest, it's go home and watch the Tennis Channel, if I'm absolutely honest with you. You know, I'm not very good at knowing what I want to do next. I find that stories come to me in some way and speak to me in different ways at different times. As I've got older, I find it difficult to, in fact, I won't do a story that I don't, that I can't see myself inside somehow or another, somehow. So I don't know. But what I think is really powerful in this is that, and I'm trying to develop it more and more in the storytelling of the piece, is that because of the nature of the CSC space on three sides, it allows the performers to truly talk not expect an answer, but address the audience in a very intimate, natural, campfire kind of way that I think is really is a powerful thing anyway. And you said about, you know, they were ignoring the fourth wall. Well, this ignores all the walls because there are really none. So it would be something that took us further down that route in some way.
I mean, what I've appreciated about what John has done for us is when we thought about, you know, why should CSC do musicals? I mean, this is an extraordinary city. There's tremendous opportunities on Broadway, off Broadway to do musicals. What does little CSC have to offer? And the only two things that we could think of was we love classics, and we think the American musical is America's chit in the classic repertory in a way, in a big, huge, fabulous way. And we thought, well, we're small, we're intimate. We can have classics up close. You know, it's like a close-up of a classic. And so why not a close-up of a musical? And what I love about John's sensitivity of choosing material is that he's chosen two pieces that may have been just in spaces that were just too big, just too large, you know, and that benefit from being a little closer to the story. And
it's always interesting too that, you know, a space will make you rethink how you work. It always amused me with passion, you know. People would say, I would say, well, you know, we can't have a, I don't know if you know passion, but, you know, we can't have a bed because there's nowhere to put it when we don't need it. And then you go, well, how can you do passion without the bed? Where are they going to be at the beginning? How could they not have the bed? And you think, oh, God, it's theater. We can do anything we want. And we have this incredible facility available to us as human beings, as theater makers, which is the audience's imagination.
Right. They make the bet.
They make the bet. I mean, it's so easy and would be so much less expensive if more people followed that possibility.
And the other thing for us, and then I think we should call it an evening, and thank everyone for this glorious work. Oh, thank you so much for asking that. That is such a good question. Who are you, and can we hire you in our department for marketing?
Chapin, John Doyle.
So, Jeff, when are we? It starts previews November 1st.
November 1st.
ClassicStage.org. Right. We're on 13th Street down in the Village, you know, Union Square area. But you know, and the other thing for us is for us, it's great to just be able to give a chance, you know, to say to Richard Rodgers over, in a way, wherever he is out there, you know, you wanted to see Allegro again. Okay, here's a chance for us to give back. So. Thank you.